they get on my nerve too every now and then. But God will give you supernatural ability because love is really supernatural. You can't love people in and of yourself. Then look at John chapter 15, verse 12. John chapter 15, verse 12. I want you to see what the Bible says there as well. John chapter 15, verse number 12. He says, "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you." Then look at verse number 17. Look at what he said there. Verse number 17. The Lord will show us. He says, "These things I command you, that you love one another." Well, what are you trying to tell me? You want us to love each other?
Amen.
Yes, that's exactly what I'm trying to say.
Amen.
I need you to learn to love one another. Then I want you to see this in Romans chapter 5, verse number 5. Romans chapter 5, verse number 5. The Lord is talking about love. He says, "In hope, make it not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given to us." Now, the way we understand love is that God must first give us the Spirit to love. Now, you'll find over there connected to Romans 5:5, you'll find in Acts chapter 5, and around verse 32, the Bible says, God gives his Spirit to all them that obey him. Now, when you think about how that's connected to Romans 5:5, you'll understand if God doesn't give you his Spirit, then you're none of his, first of all. But you don't have the ability to love one another the way he loved you.
Amen.
So all this is connected. And so it's not by chance and not by happenstance. God says, when you love me and when you obey me, you will receive my Spirit, who will then enable you to love others. 1 John chapter 4, verse number 7. 1 John chapter 4, verse number 7. I want you to see this. 1 John chapter 4, verse number 7. Beloved, let us love one another. For the love of God, is of God, and everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. In other words, the way God shows his manifestation in a person is not simply by saying, "I created you." See, we are all created by God, but not everybody is a child of God.
Amen.
Do you understand what I'm saying?
Amen.
We're all created by God, but we're not all children of God. Would that make sense, preacher? God created me, so he created you. We are not Christians by birth. I know people say that. You know, I'm born into church. Anybody heard that before?
Amen.
Amen. And you might have been born in a church, but you weren't born in the church. We're not Christians by birth. We are Christians by rebirth. Catch that. There's a difference. You're born once, but if you're not born twice, you're not twice.
Amen.
Ah, that's good. That's good preaching right there, preacher. Amen. If you're born once and not reborn, you're not twice.
Amen.
But if you're born twice, when you die, you're only die once.
Amen.
Make that plain. Well, here's the truth. You have to be reborn. You have to be reborn in the body. You know, there was a young man who said, "Well, I don't understand Jesus." He says, How can I be reborn? I can't go back into my mother's womb." Jesus said, "No, I'm not talking about that." He says, "Unless you're born of the Spirit and water, you can't see the kingdom of God. You've got to be born again spiritually." Well, I'm a good person. I don't kill anybody. I don't steal. I don't rob. I don't curse much. Amen. Only when I get mad. Amen. All that's well and good, but unless you're reborn, unless you are born in the water and Spirit, never said, you must see what is in order to be saved. He never said that. But I guarantee you, if you don't do it, you won't see.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. And so, brothers and sisters, as we go back to Hebrews, I want you to understand, the Hebrew writer is trying to emphasize, he's trying to reiterate the fact that we must love, we must love, we must love. John chapter 1, and verse number 12, we must love. This is an indication, this is a sign that points to the fact that we are God's children. And if we don't love, and I fear in the body of Christ, we'll move further and further away from it. We think of every excuse not to do it. But God says you have to do it. John chapter 1, verse 12. John chapter 1, verse number 12. I want you to see what the Bible says here. John chapter 1, verse number 12. The Bible says, but as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. God has to give you the power. You don't have it in and of yourself, brothers and sisters. We have to be given it by God. Then the Bible goes on to say, in verse number 3, marriage is honorable in all, and the bed undefiled. But whoremongers and adulterers, God will judge. This particular text seems to be somewhat disjointed from the rest of the section of the text, because it seems as though the thought changes. He goes from loving strangers and loving those in the body of Christ, but then he talks about marriage. He says marriage is honorable. Marriage is good. The late comedian George Burns, you remember he played in a lot of movies. He was a sort of risque comedian. He said once, he says, I remember when the air was clear and when the sex was dirty. But I want to clarify something. Sex has never been dirty. But sex is dependent on the place in which it is done. God only gives sex in marriage. And for our modern audience, let me clarify more. The Bible says in the book of Genesis, man shall leave his father and mother and cling to his wife. Not his partner. And the word cling there implies that they're anatomically able to.
Amen. Amen.
I'm trying to keep, y'all need to help me now. Y'all act like y'all know what I'm talking about. Amen. Anatomically connected.
Amen.
If you play with Legos, you know, the Lego had a part that stuck out in the other part, the back side. Amen. You can take the Lego and you can try to put the front side to the back side, amen, and it wouldn't work. Amen. You got to have a plug and a receptacle.
Amen.
Am I making this up? Y'all don't know what I'm talking about. And so the point is, you can't change what God has already said. Oh, Brother Clark, you're just homophobic. I'm not homophobic. I'm just telling you what the Bible says. Well, I got friends that love one another, and they're in a loving relationship with God bless them. But they're not married. See, the government doesn't have the right to change the definition. You're together, but you're not married. And if you don't get out of that, God will judge you.
Amen.
That's not hate. Now, that's going to be hate speech in another few years. Amen. They're going to try to arrest it in another few years.
Amen.
Because when they become a majority, then they're going to outlaw anything that doesn't align with their father. So as long as I have freedom today, I'm going to teach the word.
Yes, amen.
And I'll do it tomorrow. Amen.
Amen.
He says the marriage is honorable in all. And watch this. The bed, the politics, the Greek, is undefiled. Do you see that?
Amen.
He says, but whoremongers. He uses this term, whoremongers. He says, there are a group of people that are in the bed, but they're not supposed to be in the bed. If it's not husband and wife in bed, doesn't matter what you think, it's whoremongering.
Amen.
Help me, somebody. I know that's not popular preaching. I know folks don't like that. Folks get real tight. I don't care if you get tight. It's the truth. And even in the church, we got to get out of that.
Yes, amen.
If you're a young person, and you got a boyfriend, and you got a girlfriend, and, oh, they're going to leave me. They'll find somebody, they'll find somebody else. But he loves me, I love him, we have these feelings. Listen, you always got those feelings anyway. But your feelings will change.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Susie used to be crazy about Susie. Then Sally came by, amen. Then crazy about Sally. Bobby was big and strong 10 years ago, but Bobby who? So he says, whoremongers, that includes fornicators, that includes homosexuals, that includes heterosexuals that have sex outside the bond of marriage. Anything sexual, that means incest, that means bestiality, sex with animals. Anything outside the bond that God has prescribed for sex to be enjoyed is whoremongering. Then he goes on to say, he says, and adulterers, God will judge. He says, let your conversation be without covetousness. Now I want you to see, he talks about love. Love includes the marriage bed, and it includes the way we walk. That's what the word conversation means. It's a word in the Greek that means the way you live your life. He says, let it be without covetousness. The word covetousness means avarice. That means a desire. Literally means a hunger for silver. But silver represents money. The Bible talks about 1 Timothy chapter 3. Talks about an elder. One of the requirements for eldership is that he should not be money hungry. Amen. I find it fascinating. And this is just personal. This is me. I always find it fascinating that they always worry about the preacher. Yeah, that preacher better not. He always asks for money. He always asks for money. Amen. But they ain't never said that about the elders.
Amen. Amen.
Yeah, they don't have a problem for the preacher. Amen. Thank God. Amen.
Amen.
That doesn't mean the preacher should be money hungry either. Amen. But it says the elders should not be money hungry. He says, here's how you walk. He says, and be content. That means be sufficient. Whatever you have, be thankful. Doesn't mean you don't strive for more. That means you don't, okay, I got these clothes I've had since 1986. I'm just going to keep the same clothes. I'm not going to buy anything new. The Bible says be content. That's not what I'm talking about. Well, I got the remnant I've had since 74, and still, I got 347,000 miles, and I'm going to keep this remnant. I got the wood panel kit on the side, 12-inch rims. I'm going to keep this car. The Bible says be content. That's not what I'm talking about. I got my GED and I'm trying to go back to school because the Bible tells me, the Bible says, be content with what you got. That's what I'm talking about. You can strive to be content at the same time. This context is referring to the fact that you are desirous to the degree that it becomes almost your Lord. You should be sufficient with what you have.
Amen.
Let me tell you, if you go home today and you got some hamburger helper, amen, you got a little white rice, amen, a little bit of butter. And then you turn on the TV, and you see somebody in the ocean there eating filet mignon, amen. You should be there, oh man, I wish that was me. I want that filet mignon. I'm there. That looks so good. And you lust over it, and it becomes something that you strive for, and you can't think of anything else. You know, we got a lot of that in our society today because people make things look so good, especially on social media. You ever see, when you look on Facebook, one of the first things you do, you see people have pictures of themselves. Ooh, here I am in Cancun. You know, oh, look at me. Oh, well, happy birthday to me. And oh, look at my new 2019 Escalade. Look at, you know. Happy that stuff. Ain't theirs in the first place.
Amen.
They created this lifestyle that's just as where we feel like if we don't keep pushing, you know, we got the $300,000 house, and you know, now it's just two of us, but we got one, now we got to work three jobs, you know, because we got to maintain appearance. We want nobody to see us driving, you know, Toyota Corolla. We got to have the big body Benz, amen. We got to have a G-Wagon, you know. And then we getting all this dead, and now we stressed about now I can't come to church, but I got another job, and I can't. Listen, God didn't tell you to get all that dead. Spend the money you ain't got trying to impress people that don't like you. Am I talking to someone that's
wrong?
Yeah, but that's what we do. I got to buy some more of this hair. I got to buy some eyelashes. I got to buy that. I got to buy Christian Louboutin. I got to buy this. I got to get this new slick, you know, this new suit. I got to go down here and get this. Says be content with such things as you have. For he has said, watch this, I will never leave you. He says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Why is that important? Because God will always make sure you have what you need.
Amen.
David put it this way, I was young and old, yet have I never seen the righteous forsaken, all his seed them being. God will never have you in a condition where you're on the street corner. Now let me tell you, you may put yourself in that condition. In my old congregation, we would have people that would come to the church and ask for benevolence. They would say, my bills are due, and I'm about to get kicked out, and I need some help. Leadership would say, let's sit down and let's discuss the matter. Well, I don't really have the time. See, they're going to get on me tomorrow. They're going to keep me. So I need $400 to pay. And so, okay, let's see what we can do. Let's see what we can do. Matter of fact, we need it all $400. Let's talk about it. Okay. What do we need to talk about? Okay, well, that's it. What you need $400? Well, you don't understand. The cable guy's coming tomorrow. He's going to cut it off. Yeah. You know, and then I got Netflix. I got Hulu. I got to get that paid. So you come to us so that you can get money to pay him. To get him. Not to like me. But you can't be. See, in society, some of us, we beg for our needs and we spend on our wants. See, what we like to do is to come at the last minute now.